I'm Jonathan Dean, Seattle Opera dramaturg, and welcome to Opera Education from Quarantine here in virtual McCaw Hall, brought to you through the courtesy of Zoom. I'm the host of Seattle Opera Podcast, and today with this video, we're launching a new series of online opera talks, bringing you all sorts of information about opera composers and other interesting opera-related topics. Today, I want to talk to you about Giacomo Puccini. Giacomo Puccini, one of the real titans of the opera world, one of the figures on opera's Mount Rushmore. There is a little Mount Rushmore of opera composers. It's Mozart, Verdi, Wagner, and Puccini. Puccini, the most recent of them, and a composer who really was looking backwards and looking forwards at the same time. There's something very interestingly kind of both conservative, almost reactionary about Puccini, and at the same time, progressive, forward-looking, optimistic, sort of future-oriented. He's a person who had a foot in the 19th century, certainly, but lived much of his life in the 20th century. And I think it's that sort of being both of the past and of the future. The world changed a lot during Puccini's lifetime, and the idea of what art was and what opera was for changed during that time. He embodied a lot of that. And I think that is part of the magic that makes Puccini so compelling, so captivating to all who love this art form. So what I want to do here is take you on a quick whistle-stop tour of Puccini's operas and then delve in a little bit into just a couple musical examples. His first great opera, Manon Lescaut, is the one that really put him on the map as a great opera composer. It's also the opera where he learned what he needed from a librettist. That's an opera composer's collaborator in storytelling, the person who writes the poem. And Puccini went through about 7 librettists working on Manon Lescaut. What kind of story is this? Well, actually, this one is a kind of story that is similar to a lot of 19th century operas. I would call this one a French grand opera light. French grand opera was usually a historical kind of costume drama romance thing. That was a little bit earlier in the 19th century, and by the time Puccini was writing this, the complexity and the expense of doing French grand opera had become too much. So a lot of them were doing, it was very popular, but they were doing these slightly smaller, a little bit more manageable versions. And that's what that opera is. A lot of composers might have gone for this subject, but Puccini sank his own genius into it and then came up with this fascinatingly kind of terrifying roller coaster of passion, this soprano and this tenor who want it all and who end up with absolutely nothing. Interesting opera, and then follow that up with his first, super, super great masterpiece, La Bohème. Now, what kind of a story is La Bohème? Usually they call the genre of that opera verismo, meaning reality, real life, just taken and put up there on the opera stage. I'd go you one step further and say that actually La Bohème is a reality TV show. It is real world Seattle. 1890s, edition. It is about a bunch of 20-somethings who live in an apartment and their dating lives. I mean, there is no plot to La Bohème. The plot of Bohème, Act 1, they go to dinner. And, after intermission, there's, are we going to break up? Are we not going to break up? We are going to break up. We aren't going to break up. And it's very sad at the end, but it's not a tragedy, technically. You have to have a plot for there to be a tragedy. Depends on cause and effect. Tragedy means something awful happens and it's your own fault. In La Bohème, something awful happens, but no one's responsible. It's just life, verismo. That's what life is like. We put that up on stage. So very different kind of thing, totally different from his first opera. And then he switched and did something else entirely different with the next opera, which was Tosca. Tosca, I mean, it looks a little bit like that French grand opera light kind of historical costume drama, except the way the story works in Tosca, I would describe it really as a thriller, because with Tosca, this is now we are in the 20th century, and this sets up the sort of prototype for how a 20th century storyteller tells a gripping story that keeps everybody in the edge of their seats. Oh my God, what's going to happen next? This is where Alfred Hitchcock learned it all from. This is where the people who made Casablanca learned how you tell a story is really from how Puccini gives us this 3-act battle between Floria Tosca and her admirer, Baron Scarpia. Fantastic opera. If you don't know it, go find out about it and then join us in May of 2020, because it's just so much fun. I mean, it's a dark piece, but it's also a blast. he got, Puccini got much more serious with his opera that followed that, Madame Butterfly, an opera which actually he had to do twice because he didn't quite get it right the first time, and a different type of story. Now, Butterfly resembles a, to some extent, a 19th century popular opera genre called the Orientalist Romance, but Puccini again takes that beyond one step. Orientalist romance is generally very, very pretty thing about a, you know, love story, usually between a guy from the West and a lady from the East. What's different in Butterfly is it's a tragedy. And the tragedy, you know, it's where, that's where I said it's your own fault that this ended so badly, is they're both deluded and they think they're living in the Orientalist romance and not actually seeing the reality, which is a very different thing. Butterfly is not a romantic, pretty piece. It is harrowing. We did it a couple of years ago at Seattle Opera, and everyone thought that it was absolutely of the moment of today. He did write some operas that later on in his career, they weren't quite such downers, including the piece that he wrote right after Butterfly, which is, where is it? Hello. Ah, yeah. La Fanciulla del West, the girl of the Golden West. For Puccini, this was optimism. This, first of all, a totally different kind of story. It's a Western, complete with, there's a horse on stage and the hero and heroine ride the horse off into the sunset. Well, actually, they're so optimistic, they're riding off into the sunrise at the end of this particular opera. But for Puccini, the Girl of the Golden West represented possibility and hope and the West and America and this, none of the old nonsense of Europe that was quickly leading to World War I. None of that was relevant. We were just going to make something of ourselves in this new raw land. World War I interfered with his, you know, the flow of his career, so he didn't write any operas for the while. And then he wrote one little Viennese operetta. Don't worry too much about that. When he came back from the war, he had put together three short operas, one-act operas, that he presented as a triptych, a Il Trittico. And again, totally different types of stories, each of them a masterpiece. Il Tabarro is a, well, actually, Il Tabarro is more verismo, I would say, even than La Bohème. It's actually, technically, they call Tabarro Grand Guignol, which is a form of theater that was very popular in the early 20th century, where the idea is to gross the audience out with this really, really grisly, you know, climax. We get that in that opera. Then Suor Angelica, which is a religious melodrama that has this very strangely ambiguous kind of Wagnerian ending that might be transcendence or it might be something much, much, much nastier. And then, oh yeah, and then Puccini's only comedy, Gianni Schicchi. And a very sick and twisted comedy it is, and very, very funny. Puccini's last opera, Turandot, he did not live to complete. He died in 1924. Turandot first performed in 1926. And he had written it, he just wasn't happy with the ending, and the ending doesn't quite work. But kudos to Puccini for always trying something new, for never resting on his laurels. This one, a story genre, again, nothing like anything he'd ever done, an Arabian Nights kind of fairy tale, with hopefully a fairy tale positive ending, but as I say, that's the one that he didn't quite, hadn't quite nailed. Before he ran out of time and lung cancer. Anyways, so there's a very quick overview of Puccini. Now, he never repeated himself story-wise. Did he repeat himself musically? There is a Puccini sound. We talked already about Puccini looking both forward and backward, being both a conservative, nostalgic figure for a faded past and also a person with optimism and hope for the future. These are both key emotional states, and he really does give us music for those. I mean, it's Puccini's emotional music. That's why he's the most popular opera composer of all. We love crying our eyes out when Puccini is twisting the screws on us musically. We loved cheering and bursting into wild applause when a Puccini character, tenor or soprano, hits a high note and is surging with excitement and life and opportunity and optimism. This is how we respond to these operas as we go through. So I want to give you a little sort of some samples of these things as we look through it. And going back and forth, as I say, between the Puccinian nostalgia, which is always, that's really Puccini's basic emotional state. And nostalgia, keep in mind, the actually a little word nerd moment here. The etymology of the word comes from the Greek nostos and algos. Literally, nostalgia is the pain of wanting to return home, the yearning for that sense of I belong there. Actually, Puccini's, there's a very specific term for it. They call it mestizia toscana, a Tuscan sorrow, this wonderfully sweet, sad melancholy that's so delicious, served up there in northern Italy with garlic and olive oil. You hear it in La Bohème. La Bohème is basically a big exercise in nostalgia, a little music of nostalgia for that great duet that opens Act 4. And at this point, our two guys, Rodolfo and Marcello, have broken up with their girlfriends, and they both sing this, oh, I really miss me, I miss Musetta. I long for that love that we had, that sense of belonging, as we get that that classic sound of Puccinian nostalgia. Flip over to the other side of the aisle now for a little moment from Tosca, with has not so much nostalgia, but hope. We could get the nostalgia from Tosca. It's there as well. But I want to go back and forth a little bit. And with some of these examples, I will be giving you the words because they might be important. This one, let's see, where are we in the situation? Tosca and Cavaradossi, our tenor and our soprano, we're in Act 3, and we think there's a chance for escape here. We've killed the bad guy. We've got the letter of transit. We can get on the plane from Casablanca. Blanca and off to hope and new world and so forth, except Cavaradossi deep down kind of knows that this hope is fake. And yet he chooses at this point in the drama, rather than bemoan or bewail his fate or sing another nostalgic thing, he's already sung his great nostalgic aria, he'll spend the last couple minutes of his life thinking about optimism with his girlfriend and planning for a great future. And what amazing music they come up with in that duet as the sun rises over the Castel Sant'Angelo. Folgorare I cieli e scolorire, vedrò nell'occhio tuo rivelatore, e il nome va nelle cose più pure, avrà da te voce. I love that little sting of pentatonic music right there, that sort of Eastern melody. That's almost like Puccini starting to write Butterfly a couple years early. I want to play a little moment from Butterfly, which is so key. This is this guy, I mean, this really is the nostalgia of Odysseus, because here's a sailor sailing all over the world, bedding women in every port. In Nagasaki, he goes so far as to marry a woman, which gives her the wrong idea, as you can imagine. All the while, he's constantly thinking about home and hearth and wife and family, and I want to go back to America. And his theme song is the Star Spangled Banner. The moment I want to play for you is when he says that terrible line in the very first scene, before we've even met Butterfly, he says, I drink to the day when I will marry a real American woman someday. And it's not even that he's being cruel to Butterfly. I mean, he's not even thinking about her. He's not aware of her. He's drowning in that homesickness and that nostalgia. You hear that in his music with this line. This line is like the Ides of March in Julius Caesar. It tells us exactly what the tragedy is going to be. But the feeling of it is, oh, I miss the folks back home.
America.
Benjamin Franklin Pinkerton is probably Puccini's most nasty image of himself, a well-known Italian womanizer put up on the opera stage. I think the most positive character in all of Puccini is probably the girl of the Golden West, the heroine of his next opera, which, as I mentioned, is this kind of rags-to-riches American Horatio Alger optimism type story from 1910, Minnie, the girl of the Golden West. And she is a saloon gal, runs a saloon in California in the gold rush. And here's what I mean by the hope and the optimism of it. She meets this striking young city feller who's very sophisticated, and she doesn't, again, the twist, she doesn't really know what this guy is all about, but she wants to be worthy of him, and she's going to raise herself up, up, up by her bootstraps, up to her high C, so that she can be with him. Bit of Puccini and hope, optimism there from Fanciulla. We'll flip back to the extreme nostalgia, longing for that lost paradise, so extreme that it becomes, like in Butterfly, tragedy and delusion. And this is in Suor Angelica. Sister Angelica is a nun who's been shunted away into a convent because she bore a kid out of wedlock. And in her opera, basically, somebody comes to her and says, your kid is dead. So she gathers poisonous herbs from the garden at the convent to kill herself so that she can go and be with her baby again. And it's the most stirring scene. And then, of course, about 3 minutes after this ecstatic music that I'm going to play you, she realizes, oh, wait, suicide, that's a mortal sin. I'm not going to paradise, I'm going to hell. And the music becomes even more intense. But let's listen now, as I say, this almost Wagnerian music of transcendent ecstasy in her extreme nostalgia to go back to that lost paradise. Wow, is that opera powerful? I want to leave you not with nostalgia and that sort of backwards looking Puccini. I want to leave you with a little bit of the optimism, with the hope. So I'm going to end with one of my favorite moments in all Puccini, the tenor aria from Gianni Schicchi. That's that black comedy that I mentioned. Puccini trying to figure out, what do we do after World War One? And the situation here, our wealthy old curmudgeon has died, and his family has got all blue blood, you know, very, very proud of their aristocratic name, but they're all broke. So they're trying to figure out how to get the old guy's money. He's left it all to the monastery. And the nephew, the tenor, the young man, sings, oh, what we need is my girlfriend's dad. He's super clever and crafty, and he'll be able to figure out the situation. And the relatives are all, no, he's from the country. He's a rustic. We can't possibly associate with him, and you can't marry that guy's daughter. At which point he sings this aria, and it's fantastic. To me, this is Puccini's, probably his political philosophy of what should the 20th century really be, because Renuccio sings to all of them, shut up. what makes our city great, this is all happening in Dante's Florence, what makes it so that the Renaissance is going to happen here is here the best idea wins. Here we do have an aristocracy, but it's of whatever works, whatever is going to make go to the general good. So here the words really are important. I'm going to play this little aria and give you super titles so you can follow through the logic as well as the passion of the character singing Puccini's hope for what the future might be.
Firenze con un albero fiorito, che in piazza dei signori a tronco e fronte, muore radici, forza nuove apportano, dalle compagni limpide e feconde. E Firenze germoglia delle stelle, salvo paletti, salvi e torri sen. L'arno prima di correre alla foce, così scendam vidotti in arti e scienze a far più vita speranti da Firenze e di bandesa giù dalle castella ben venga Arnolfo a far la torre bella e venga giunto dal Mucel Servoso il medici mercante coraggioso. Basta con gli odi grecchi e poi ripicchi, viva la gente nuova e canni schicchi.
An aristocracy of arts and sciences based on the tradition, respecting the history, but always forward-looking, always a place where the best idea wins. I think Puccini might have really liked Seattle. Seattle certainly likes Puccini. We've been doing Puccini's operas at Seattle Opera since 1964, and we will do them again. We hope to see you all there, and we'll be back here before too long with more opera education. Thanks for joining me today.